This is Bill Ryan from Project Camelot and Project Avalon, and the date is the 16th of February 2010. And this is a bit of an unusual video presentation here, because I'm taking the step of making a video as an interpretation and as a commentary on an audio interview which we did with an important witness who came and reported his story to Project Camelot a little while ago, about a couple of weeks ago. And as with many of our witnesses, this person wanted to remain anonymous, but he has agreed that we transcribe the audio, and so we've got this as a transcript. And this is going to be released at the same time as the video, because it's important to be able to read the transcript at the same time as you're considering what I'm saying about it here. And as we come into this story, you're going to understand exactly why it's important to get all the information, to hold it all into a very fine balance. Now, this is a British person, and he worked in the British military for a number of years. And after he retired from the military, he worked in the City of London, in a fairly senior position, in a respected position, in the City of London. And for those people watching this video who don't know about the City of London is like, it's like an enclave, it's like a financial enclave in the heart of London itself. Some people consider it almost a little bit like the Vatican. It's very old, it's very ancient. It's the heart of the financial system, not only of Britain, but possibly the world. Many researchers consider that it's very likely that the City of London calls the shots on the financial systems in America. They've got control over the Federal Reserve, the Bank for International Settlements, a whole bunch of things that happen. This is like the nerve center of the financial world. And it's very Masonic, it's very ancient, it's very traditional. And our source attended a number of meetings with senior Masons. And while many of these were interesting, they were routine by City of London standards. They were discussing financial affairs and so on and so forth. And then in the June 2005, he attended another meeting that he thought was going to be a routine meeting, but actually this was something rather unusual, and he realized it was unusual as soon as he arrived. In fact, in his interview with us, the one which we have the transcript of, you will see that he says that he felt it was an accident that he was there. He shouldn't really have been there. He didn't know what was happening. And as such, he didn't really participate in the meeting. He was there as a little bit as a fly on the wall. He was just listening to what was happening. And at first, he didn't even understand what was being discussed. Now, the people there were Masons. They were senior Masons. They were about 25 or 30 people there, including senior politicians who most people in the UK would recognize by name. I do not know who they were. He didn't name them, and I didn't ask them, but he said these are well-known names. The chief of police was there, representatives from the church, representatives from the military, 25 or 30 people. And as he listened to this story being discussed, it was an informal meeting. It wasn't like at a big table with kind of notepads and water glasses and minutes and an agenda and a chairman. There were just people in a room who were talking about all of this stuff. And what they were talking about was a plan that had clearly been made a long time ago, and what they were discussing was they were discussing the implementation of this plan. They were discussing how things were going, whether they were on track or not. And what, for example, to give a flavor of this, they were discussing between them some of the problems that they had in the implementation of their plan. And as this little presentation continues here, you will realize what the plan was, and I'm going to be revealing this in very much the same way as it was revealed to our witness and as he revealed it to me, bit by bit, step by step. The first thing that he heard was they were talking about the fact that Israel didn't look as if it was getting prepared to attack Iran anytime soon. This was a problem. Even back in June 2005, they were apparently concerned that what it was that was planned on some kind of a timeline wasn't rolling out according to schedule, and this was an issue for them. So that attracted his attention very quickly, because he'd never been in a meeting when this kind of thing was discussed. Then they were talking about China and how powerful China was getting, both militarily and financially, very quickly, and that the Japanese weren't doing what they were supposed to do, which was to interfere in some way with the Chinese financial system. They weren't doing that, and this was another problem because China was getting too strong too quickly. Other things that were discussed were, for example, the coming financial crash, the centralization of resources, everything that we saw starting to happen in October 2008. They were planning that and referring to it in their meeting in June 2005. So there was clearly a rollout of some plan here, and he was quite shocked the more that he heard, and when he really realized what was happening, he was extremely shocked. And one of the reasons why I'm giving this video presentation now is to soften the blow and interpret this a little tiny bit, because it is shocking information. And what I also want to do is I want to try and differentiate out between what it was that he reported, because he'd heard it with his own ears, and what it is that is his speculation and my speculation about how all this fits together. It's very important information. We need to know this stuff. Even though it doesn't look like it's going to be on track, I don't think this will happen. I think that there are a bunch of crazy people there who are extremely determined to do something, and they were in a hurry, and this is important to understand, they were in a rush to try and roll out this sequence of events. Now, what he described is what the sequence of events was. It starts with Israel attacking Iran. Now, this hasn't happened yet. There have been a number of indications that there are forces which are trying to push this into happening. You've only got to follow the news for the last 2 years to realize that the public is being prepared for a justification for this kind of thing. Iran is being set up as being the bad guys that deserve something to happen to them, and so on and so forth. Now, that's going to be the start of what is like the opening gambit in a big chess game. And the plan is to provoke Iran or China to retaliate. And our guy, our source, who is a military man, is privately as convinced as he can be, although this has never been made public and this is not publicly known, that Iran does have nuclear weapons. He believes that they have been provided by China behind the scenes. And all of this is intended, because it's all right with these controlling forces that Iran has nuclear weapons, because they want them to be used. The plan is for either Iran or for China to retaliate after Iran is struck with a nuclear weapon. At that point, there will be a limited nuclear exchange in the Middle East, followed by a ceasefire. He heard this being planned in this meeting. This is being choreographed. It's like the script for a movie. This is exactly what's intended to happen. And during this time, the other thing that's being set up for this, and many people watching this will be aware that this is being set up in the background. We've had a lot of information about this from a number of good researchers from many countries who are reporting this on the internet, that things are being set up in many of the Western countries for there to be heavy controls over populations, martial law, increased powers on security forces who are not just the army or the police, but in Britain, for example, our source said that he absolutely knew personally for a fact that a very large number of private security people, their powers were being increased to give them the ability to arrest people, the ability to detain, the ability to handle riots in streets. And here we're talking about just regular people working in private security, people who give the parking tickets on the streets. Their powers are being increased in the same way. And last year, we heard President Obama talking about how he wanted to have a sort of National Guard at home in America, ready to handle this kind of thing. There are a lot of indicators that this is being set up. And in this rollout of this crazy scenario, where it is intended that there will be a limited nuclear exchange in the Middle East, the idea is that as the world looks upon this with horror, then they will demand from their governments that there are heavy controls over travel, over communication, over people who meet, over people who protest in the streets. They want to make sure that they don't have crazy bombers on airplanes, crazy bombers in the shopping malls. They want to make sure, and because people will be driven into fear by this, they'll request and demand and insist on heavy controls from their governments, which will be justified. And this is where you're going to kind of get the martial law situation in all the Western countries. It's intended as a justification. All of this is just the start of something, because this story gets much bigger, and it's pretty horrifying. And if watching this now you're feeling a little bit shocked, this is how I was feeling when I heard this information, and this is how our source was feeling when he was hearing this information in this meeting, because this is just the beginning. Now, during the time of this ceasefire, everyone's shocked, everyone's frightened, everyone's really terrified about where this is going to go. There are all kinds of heavy controls over populations everywhere. And then the next thing that happens in this chess game that's being played is that biological weapons are released on China. He heard this being discussed in this meeting. They will release a flu-like virus that will be genetically targeted against the Chinese population. It's racially targeted against the Chinese people. It's designed to spread like wildfire and to knock out a large number of the Chinese people. And these people in this meeting were laughing about this. They said, China will catch a cold. Those were their words. China will catch a cold. And they were laughing about the fact that these biological weapons will wreak havoc among the Chinese population. And after that, then what effectively will be a kind of plague will actually spread right across the world to the West as well. Our source was not clear whether this was a Chinese retaliation or whether the thing would just spread out of control in the way that it would be very understandable if it did, whether it's racially targeted or not. These things actually mutate. So now you've got a situation where there's been a limited nuclear war in the Middle East. There's a pandemic that really is sweeping across the world and really is killing people very visibly. And you've got this totalitarian military lockdown in all the governments in the Western world because everyone's going to be in panic about all of this. And then, he said, then the real war starts. Something that would be justifiably called the Third World War with a much more major nuclear exchange. And at this point, I asked him, is this just about population reduction? What is this about? Why are they doing this? Why this insane Dr. Strangelove plan for just unleashing all of this stuff on the world? Why do it? Now, as our conversation went on, I started to find answers to those questions. Now, some of this is speculation. I want to share this speculation with you because it's important enough that we work together here to figure out what's going on. And there are some clues, there's some very important clues that I'm going to present to you here in this video. He said, absolutely, it's about population reduction. So I said, well, in this meeting, did they mention any figures? And he said, yes, they did, 50%. Half the world's population, this is planned as per the Georgia Guidestones. For those of you who don't know what the Georgia Guidestones are, it's a stone monument in Georgia in America that was erected anonymously a number of years ago. It's in 8 languages, and it's like an Illuminati manifesto for a new world, as it were. And just hold that thought about this being a manifesto for a new world. This is an important concept here in what I'm presenting. One of the key parts of this manifesto for this new world is that there should be a population of 500 million people. Now, 500 million people is an enormous reduction from the nearly 7 billion that we've got at the moment. That's pretty much 95% of people who would no longer be on this planet. And 50% is a step towards that. And there's a reason why they're doing all of this. There's a reason why they're in a hurry. There's a reason for this insanity. And when he was explaining this, then he said that they have a name for this plan. This project has got a name. And I said, well, what is this name? He said, it is called the Anglo-Saxon Mission. The Anglo-Saxon Mission. Now, I'd heard that before. It was something historical, I think, to do with the Crusades quite a long time ago. But I hadn't heard it in the present day context, and neither had he. And later on, as he continued to tell his story, I began to understand what I thought this might be about. Hence the title of this video, and the reason why I want to share this information with you, because we need to work together to figure out what's going on here. It's extremely important to understand. There's a plan, I believe, that Hitler would be proud of, which is so evil, it's so Machiavellian, it's so hard to face up to, it's so unbelievable, that I need to put it on the table for you so that you can consider whether or not this might be a possibility. The plans that I've been describing are definitely a possibility because he heard them with his own ears in this meeting. Everything I've described up until now, up to and including a major outbreak of hostilities after the limited war. So the sequence is as follows. The plan sequence is as follows. Israel attacks Iran, then there's a ceasefire, then during which time there is heavy governmental military controls over populations in all Western countries. Then China is attacked by a biological weapon. It's a flu-like disease that spreads like wildfire. This goes all over the world, and then they have a major Third World War. And then, by this time, 50% of the population will be destroyed. And not only because of the war or the plague, but because, as many of you watching this will understand, the infrastructure goes down in situations like this. There's no food in the supermarkets, there's no gas in the pumps, there's the telecommunication goes down, there may not even be water coming out of the taps. People are kind of thrown back into a Victorian era without